name's Late Game Reviewer and welcome to my channel. I'm going to do a review of Perpetuum. It's an MMO, just like in the most traditional form, from Avatar Creations. So I made a first impressions a couple of months ago, I believe. Maybe a year ago, sir. I can't really remember the date, but anyways, I made one, and I went like through in depth in the mission system, like what you can do in the game. So, if you really want to know like a bit more about what you're supposed to do in missions, or I don't know, like mining or anything, just go ahead, go there and look at those videos. I'm not gonna talk about in depth about the missions here, just the general overview of it. Oh, where is it? Oh, okay, there it is. And while I'm gonna do that, I'm just gonna play the game here. And I hate this little place because there's a lot of hills. Oh my god, I shouldn't have come here. Anyways, let's start with the story here. There's a lot of potential that is like seriously untapped. It starts with humans on their own planet, and they need a lot of energy. They're at a point where they need like a serious loads of energy here, and because of that, oops, hi. Will I get a problem? Ah, good. Okay, they reloaded. Yeah, there seems to be a problem with this update, as sometimes you just can't even start to, like, reload. It should be fixed. It doesn't happen all the time, but anyways. So for the story, they're at a point where humans need a lot of energy, and because of that, what they did was they just sent a probe out in space, and then they discovered some kind of wormhole, I believe. So they sent a survey or a probe inside, and they discovered this planet here. This planet, like, there's the sea here, which gets or creates electric, static electricity. There's other stuff as well, like there's something in the air or in the planet that has a lot of energy. So they found like the mother load of all energy sources. They want it. So instead of using the wormhole and create wormholes, which they can't, to send in the army and get this one here and destroy everything here, they can't do that. So they send a virus. By sending in a virus, what's happening here is, well, they can't do that, so they're just going to send in a virus, and that virus, instead of disabling all the robots, it gives them control of the robots. Yeah. So you control the robots, and that's why I'm here. So they're sending in agents, me, people you, well, people who pay the game, and they just, you are able to control a robot, so you can send in energy by doing missions and all. So that's the, I would say, main storyline. So as you can see, there's a lot of potential as who builded these buildings, like those robots, how are they made, why is there static electricity in the water and everything. There's a lot of potential here. There's like no sea craft for some reason, they never got to that point. There's no aircraft. I could go on and on, but as you can see, there's a lot of untapped potential. There's a lot of missions, not missions, but stories that is just untold. Which is some kind of a good thing, because if they want to do expansions or they want to expand this world, this universe, it's possible to do so. But unfortunately, they're not doing that right now. And if you go on the EVE Online story, I mean, this is a thing that I'm not going to do. I'm not going to compare it to that. But if you compare it to the EVE Online stories, there's a lot of stories on that one compared to this one here. If you go to the website, usually when you register, you usually want to know, well, what's the story? So you find out about the stories. You got the background stories, and you got a couple of short stories, but that's all. It's, there's just not enough. But it's really not a complaint. I mean, it, like, the game has been up for 10 years or so, so they've been doing kind of good in a way. But anyways, let's go on further here. For the graphics, it's really outdated, as you can see. But, gotta give them credit, they are original. Yes, the textures might be super bad, but I love the design. I love the like the robot design, especially in the other stages, and even in the like in the intro, when you log in the game, you can see this really big mech. I do love the design and everything. I do love the world. It's just it has some kind of a out of this world setting, which is kind of cool to me. You see all these trees, these whatever you call them, bushes or whatever. You see a lot of this around you, and even the buildings. Unfortunately, nothing of this feels alive, even though it may look cool, because it doesn't look like anything that I can relate to, which is really, really, really kind of cool. But it's lifeless. Like, if you go like near that building, for example, you're gonna see some lights, but that's it. It's just like pulsing and flashing. There's nothing else, which is kind of lame, because I would have expected something bigger, something more awesome. But no, it just pulsates. There's just pulsating lights in there. I don't know why, but this robot here is just standing there. It's usually supposed to do something, but anyways. And yeah, there's barely any NPCs around, which is kind of bad. There's barely anything going around here, except for the other agents, like you, for example, like other players. Come on. Here you go. Yeah, so that's a little bit of a problem, but, you know. Anyways, and for the music, I can't really say something like anything bad against the music. It's may not be my taste. The soundtrack is not big enough, that I can tell you. And there's the fact, which is really weird, but it's not really weird, but it would be nice to have a feature that includes shortcuts of MP3 inside of a folder so I can make my own music. Usually in a game like this, you're supposed to do that, but like in Grand Theft Auto, for example, they have the kindness to do so. It would be nice to do so in here. Little feature that could mean a lot in the end. And for the combat, I mean, this is where it starts. This is where my complaint starts, but that may be just me. It's static fights. I mean, just look at this one here, for example. I'm just going to lock him. Takes a couple of seconds to do so. You got some skills related to that, so you can make it shorter. I got it locked. I press space. Then I can shoot him. That's it. You can play with distance. You got some, like, other modules which might help you. Well, besides your guns and your missiles, you got you got different types of weapons, which have their own pros and cons. You can loot, which almost all of the modules are useful for you, either for crafting or just for research or anything. It's a really static combat system. You lock it. And you wait for the lock to complete. Then you shoot. You just fire and forget. That's the kind of system that it uses. I personally don't like that. I mean, you're in a mech. You have guns. You see the enemy. Why can't I be able to shoot him before? I personally don't get it, but I think it makes the system a lot more simple. I just don't like it. I'd love to get some kind of dynamic active system. Think of Hawkins, and why is this big? Oh my god. Think of Hawkins, for example. Oh, seriously? This is going to be large like that? Oh my god, what have I done? Okay, good. Yeah, let's make another one here. Yeah, for the request, for the assignments, while I do that, you'll see the number here, like 2, 3, and now it says next assignment will provide 140 of standard rewards. And it goes like that, like I do another one, and the reward percentage will go up as I do more missions. So this is a really good incentive to do a lot of missions, because you get bonuses, of course. Ah, this is cool. And, that's it for the combat. I mean, you can use the environment with you. I mean, especially in PvP, which means, for example, I'm not going to do PvP in this video here, but, I mean, you'll get the idea. You lock on a target, you can hide behind a tree, for example. He's not going to be able to target you. Like, the lock will not break but he won't be able to shoot you. So you can use that to your advantage. So if you use missiles, for example, as well, you'll be able to shoot over small hills, which might be an advantage to you compared to other weapons. Like my weapons, for example, EM guns. Let's reload this one here, because with EM guns, I gotta have a direct shot. And if I shoot like this right now, it's not gonna work. Oh, no, it is. But you get the idea. That's the thing. Yeah, 22 meters. That's gonna be a bit short. Let's shoot him. That's what I can say about the combat. I personally don't like it, but hey, some people do, I guess. Let's see here. And for the skills, I'm just gonna beat those. Servant grunt. I can use weapons and missiles on this one here. That's again for electromagnetic weapons. Oh, kind of missed him. What the? Boom! Alright. And now for the skills. There's a lot of skills. This is where it's really fun. You can, instead of shooting other robots and enemies, and then you get experience points, or extension points, as I call them here. In here, you log in one per day, once per 3 days, and you'll get points. And each day, you'll get a number of extension points. Right now, I've got 55,000. Tomorrow, I'm going to get, I don't know, 56 or 57 or something. I'll be able to spend them. And this is really cool because you get all of your points compared to EVE Online or any other game. You don't lose any points. You can, right now I got level 9 in contract negotiations. This in turn gives me more bonus levels. And if I do take combat specialization, for example, I'm going to get more, I would say more reward and so on and so on in combat and combat exploration. So I need, for example, 6,300 for level 7. And there's a lot of them. But if you play this for a couple of years, there might not be anything else to spend on. So they should do something about that, but anyways. Let's go to point C here and continue. This is really cool because compared to EVE Online, when you get your points, you gotta get the skill book and then you get your points. So if you lose, for example, like a couple of hours, that might be a trouble, that might be a problem because you lost them, that's it, you can't get it back. In here, you get the points first, then you get to spend them later, which is a huge advantage. You lose nothing. EVE Online should have been this way from the start, but they're not like that. Anyway, yeah, they want you to log in and everything. Like, it took EVE Online a couple of, like, massive complaints. It took him a lot to make him change to have the 24-hour queue. These guys here, you don't need queues and you don't need all that stupid shit. No. You log in, you get your points, you get to spend them later wherever you want, which is a really cool thing. And you also got some credits. I mean, I'm not supposed to talk about this, but I will. You spend some real cash, like $5 for 2,400 points, for example, which is super cheap, if you ask me. You and your agent profile and extensions, and you get an EP booster, which in turn gives you a bit more extension points, 50% more for 1 month. And you don't have to log in each 3 days, which is a serious advantage. $5 per month, man. If you do like this game a lot, this might be a solution for you. Hey, I mean, who knows? You get more points and you get to, and you're not forced to log in every 3 days. I've been doing that and it's really not of a chore. I mean, you just log in, you log out immediately. It's not really big of a problem, trust me. It's really nice. And for the skill point, that's what I can say about it. Now there's the market. This is where the problem starts. This is a game where there's a lot of, it's a player-driven market. Now, for example, if you look at the market over here, I'm on the field. I'm not in the main terminal. But if you look everywhere, like for example, all the supplies that you see here are all done by humans, like by you and me, like by players, and the demand, again, by players as well. It's like this for every other item. The problem is this. If you look at the map, there's way too many terminals, there's way too many stations, there's just way too many for the market. Like, the market is not big enough, and the world is too big. I think you can see what the problem is. If you have too many stations and too many, like, the market is way too big, there's going to be a gap. And in my market, I don't know if you're going to see that. That is my own adverts. I got some up, but they have been sold for a day. Usually in EVE Online, that would have been, like this is a big market, like 40,000 people. This game, I really know there's not 40,000 people online each day. That creates a problem because those prices might be up for a very long time. Very long time. So it's really cool that they have this player-driven market, because I do my research, I get my kernels, for example. This is a whole complex system, but it's like, if you follow it like step by step, it's simple. It's really not complicated. So I get kernels, I turn them into research points, then I get to research, like, I don't know, like the Yaggle, for example. Then I make a blueprint, then I'll be able to make that blueprint, well, an item out of that blueprint. I mean prototype, and you go, then you'll be able to get it on the field and everything. So, well, to make it and either sell it or just use it for yourself. So in the process, it's a bit cheaper. So, well, you get the idea. Whoops. I'm just going to request combat mission again because I love it. And that's the thing about the market. Really nice, but it's, yeah, just not enough here. All the game needs is a lot more players, and the problem will be fixed. And probably a solution to get your item from one place to another. If they can find a solution to that, that would be amazing. Like, if you know that your items are not sold and into one station, transfer it to another station for, I don't know, a small fee, or just find a way to do that. And not do it yourself, because that takes a lot of time, it's gonna piss a lot of people off. That would be really amazing. And there's the crafting, like I told you, it's a complex kind of system. There's a couple of steps. Nothing really too complicated. I'm not gonna explain it here, but you shoot enemies, you get kernels, then you get research points, then you can get prototypes off of those research points. And from there you can create the items. You do need other items, of course. And you just continue, like, so on and so on and so on. It's a really good system, but personally, like the mechs or the robots that you have, there's just not enough. There's just not enough modules. But of course, you can go on the forum and just go into the suggestion the suggestion area and just talk about it and tell them what other modules they can have. But I'm gonna tell you right away, there's a heavy emphasis on EVE Online, which is really not bad at all. So if you need ideas, just get an EVE Online and just copy it from there. I mean, why not? This one uses it's still an MMO like the other ones, just like an EVE Online, and it does uses it still has like a sci-fi setting. So I guess it's fine. There's no problem there. And there's a cool thing which I can't really show you right now because I'm not in the Gamma Islands, in the on the PvP islands, but you can build outposts, like buildings. Oh my god, shoot him. Yeah, you can build buildings, you can terraform the land around you, which is really cool, and they got some bonuses and advantages to that, of course. And of course you got corporations, which means you can play with other people here. I've got one here. And you do have advantages to play when you're with more than one person, of course. Especially in PvP, which makes it really fun. And yes, this game uses, well, not uses, but when you, it's just like in a term of, like, of a roguelike kind of game, like an EVE Online. You get your mech, you do a lot of money, because right now I got 2 million. You buy your mechs, and once you buy your mechs, you go out in the field and either blow up NPCs or other players. If you lose it, you lose it. You can't get it back. Same thing. And on the that's, well, that might be the bad side, but the good side is you got insurance. So the insurance might cover your loss if you did use the insurance. So, you know, you got to really, you got to be careful. So this is what makes, I would say that this would differentiate this game to another one because of the risk involved. I mean, just imagine and try to make, like, just try to think about it. You take 1 week or so to make a lot of money, you get 3 or 4 mechs or robots, you fit them with all the modules. It may be cheap, but like, that doesn't really matter. And then all of a sudden, you lose all of it because you went out on a field and you tried to kill a person, but he just got you with his own group. Number one, it pisses you off because you got ganked. And second of all, you lost your ship with 1 week of work. You want to get back and you want to learn from that. This is where the rush and all the PvP and adrenaline kicks in. This is where it's really fun. So the PvP in here can be really fun. The game can be really fun in that aspect because of the risk involved. There's a lot of other MMOs out there that doesn't offer you that kind of risk and reward. This one here has it. And lastly, before I go into my conclusion, there's also... just gonna... come on, don't get away. Just gonna get this on the side here. There's a recent patch that they got out. Just gonna get it here. Whoop, standard light missile launcher. Got some kernels. All right. There's a new patch on here, and that's why I'm doing the, I would say, like, this video here, because there's a reason specific to that that I wanted to wait. When I wanted to make the review, they were talking about the new random assignment system. You see, before, you had to go, for example, all the way to the ICS Alpha terminal, which is the main terminal for everyone. You go there, you activate a mission, it would usually send you right here, or wherever around the station, but really far away, and there's hills and everything, so you had to make your way around, which took like a long time. By the time I make this video, I'm gonna have like 2.1 million. Before, that would be like half of it. It would seriously piss me off. This is fixed because there are some terminals, but on the field, which enables me to, let's look at it, to activate missions of all kinds. And I can play with my storage, which is private in this one alone here. But I can take all this, for example, and go to the main terminal. I can even teleport to the terminal as well from this place to the terminal. And I can equip my robot on the field, which is freaking great. Personally, this should have been done from the start. But no, I can't switch mechs. That would be awesome. There's 27 assignment templates. It's in 8 categories. Before, there were like 3 categories. Combat, transport, and mining. But now it's like combat, transport, exploration, harvesting, mining, production, combat, exploring, and complex production. So everything is split up. So if you do like mining, for example, you're not supposed to fight a robot. This fixes a lot of minor issues that was really annoying. Not really a problem, but just really annoying. This was needed from the start, seriously, and this is why I have to go on my conclusion right now. This game has a lot of potential. And, like, it's been up for a long time. Like, oh my god, 10 years or so, even perhaps more, I believe. What the hell? Why isn't that shooting it? Okay, now it's shooting it. And it has this kind of sci-fi setting with robots. To me, that's a winner. On like unknown world, really weird robots, sci-fi setting. This is it. I mean, this is an MMO that's really fun to me. It's also $30. It's really cheap compared to other ones, and it doesn't ask you for a monthly subscription. So you pay it, you go on the server, and that's it. You get fun. There's not of other MMOs that does that, and even if they did, it's either filled with microtransactions, which has, oh my god, it's awful. And it's free to play because of the microtransactions, or they make you play like on a monthly basis, and it's not like good enough for that. Yes, I know this one might be outdated in more than one category, but I still recommend it, oddly enough, because of the potential in it. And I do have a surprise, because I did have, not have, but I did ask DevZoom, whoops, let's target him first, 15 questions. And that's what I'm here to talk about before I just end the video here. Come on, activate it. Good, now it's activated. And the questions, he answered me. I mean, he had the kindness to answer me, so here they are. Number one, how many active developers are working on Perpetuum? I'm just gonna tell the answer like word for word that is that he gave me. Four or five, depending on what we call active. Number two, I may stop the robot here to read it, but anyways. How many hours per week are they working? Like, how much active are they? I get the feeling some people may like this answer. I know that many people think that this is somehow of a hobby project for us, that we do it in our free time, and everyone has a separate full-time job, but that's not true. Perpetuum is our full-time job, and we're sometimes working 12 or 14 hours a day on it. I believe the answer, well, to this, like the reason of the answer, is because the patch just takes a seriously long time compared to all other games out there, and this is true. This is a big problem. I personally think this is a big problem, but with four or five active developers, I mean, how much can you go fast, you know? There might be solutions, but hey, anyways. Besides the mission assignment system change, what other quick updates are in store for Perpetuum? This is listed in the assignment testing topic. If you go there on forum, you'll find it, in other words. What are the long plans in store for Perpetuum? Once we reworked all the islands, we'll have a blog outlining this. Should be up there. Number five, did you guys think of a Kickstarter fund project with all of your ideas thrown inside since your game has a solid foundation? That's the question I gave him, because it is true. I mean, it's been up for 10 years. It's very solid. It has good potential. And frankly, this needs a graphic update. And he gave me the answer. I have answered this a couple of times in various topics, because people have asked me the same question. The truth is, if we wanted the Kickstarter project to be actually successful, we would need to set aside the development of the game and devote at least half a year of work out the campaign, do concept arts, stretches goal, etc. Because none would give money for a wall of text. This is true, and I need to put an emphasis on this, because making a Kickstarter project is not easy. You have to devote one person. You usually devote two persons on this full time, so that's two less coders at a minimum out of your work. So when these guys come in, they're not gonna code. They're gonna go on the Kickstarter page and do everything. Concept art, they do everything. The marketing, they contact people for funds. This is a full-time freaking job here. This is really hard, like, stuff to do. It's not easy to do, trust me, and sometimes it can go bad. There's a lot of Kickstarter projects that have went bad because of this. Even though I think that this would be a win, yeah. It's like a catch-22. It's always a catch-22. What is this? Okay. Oh, all right, I gotta go there. All right. And number six, regarding marketing, some people have noticed there hasn't been any for the game. Any news or updates regarding this? Proper marketing requires a lot of money that we don't have. What's your goal for Perpetuum? More players, more sales through Steam? To make it a game that people like to play, more players and more sales come with that naturally. I wanted to know about like a little bit about that, but yeah, it's a bit obvious here. Ooh, I gotta kill it. Oh my god, I gotta kill it. Looks big and juicy. Number 8. Do you plan to get more developers to work on Perpetuum? That's if they have money. Oh my god, this is freaking huge. What is it doing here? It's not supposed to be here. Their answer was, well, of course, if we can afford it. Oops. I looked at the questions. Number 9. Why does it take a long time to release a new update? Looks like everyone is... Oh yeah. They hate my guts. Yeah, I'm gonna get away. Oh my god. I think I'm gonna die here. Yeah, I died. To ease your loss of singing to get provided, and I just died. Well, it doesn't matter. I did have an insurance. A brand new Arky. So, alright, let's continue here. Why does it take a long time to release a new update? This is what happens. Like, you lose your robot, and you get transported back to your main terminal. So, yeah, that happens. And I just lost it, except for the insurance, which I got the money back. No, in fact, I did not have that one. Well, I got a lot of money, so it's really not a problem here. The assignment system is a very complex one. The only thing... Yeah, so if you attack a carrier, that's going to happen. You get blown up really easily if you're not prepared. The sign-in system is a very complex one. The only thing... Let me do the question again. Why does it take a long time to release a new update? The assignment system is a very complex one. The only thing more complex right now in the game is the Gamma Colonies. So it takes a long time to work out the mechanics and then actually develop them. But it needed to be done because the mission system was the most neglected part of the game. In the second half of the year, we'll try to make smaller... we'll try to release smaller updates, but important updates. Number 10, do you plan on releasing update shorters? Yeah, that was kind of obvious. Because I didn't know the answer to number 9. Number 11, what if funds were unlimited? What would you do with Perpetuum? Got a shitload of artists and redo all the graphics. How many years do you want to see Perpetuum alive and kicking? Hopefully a lot more. How many subscribers and how many players are on a daily basis? He can't tell me. He doesn't want to comment on those. And number 15, what if you had unlimited funds? What would you do with the game? He says that was a dupe question, but I wanted to rephrase it just in case if he didn't answer me, but yeah. I mean, I think it's really obvious. Loads of artists and graphics. This is it. Anyways, I hope you liked the review, and my name is Late Game Reviewer. I hope you liked it. If you didn't, just tell me why. And I'll see you next time. See you later.